Probably there's all sorts of instances of what we call nonviolent action, of the methods going back, you know, thousands of years. But if we look at ones that were the models which Gandhi and others used to try and develop their ideas, the important one in the mid-1800s was the struggle by Hungarians against the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And this was a struggle that went on for nearly 20 years and was successful in the end. And so there was all sorts of methods used there, such as, you know, not speaking the language, boycotts, and so forth. So there was that one, which was a model for others. And then there was the resistance in Finland to the Russian Empire at the end of the 1800s, early 1900s. So that was, again, an example that others say, oh, this is a possible method of struggle that might be actually work on a big scale. And so we tend to forget that others aren't just, you know, Gandhi wasn't working in isolation. He was in contact. He was aware of the historical examples. He was in touch with some of the leading figures like Tolstoy. So it was, it's a continuum. Gandhi made a great contribution, but he was building on the struggles of earlier groups of people. Nonviolence wasn't used against the Nazis very much. It wasn't an organized campaign. And we need to remember that there was a lot of sympathy for fascism or Nazism in the countries that which he, you know, Hitler then later attacked. So it wasn't as if, you know, they were all, you know, all the leaders were there trying to oppose Hitler. They weren't. But there's a very good documentation of nonviolent resistance in occupied Europe, especially in Norway, Denmark, Netherlands, and France, all of those parts of Europe. Even the elementary steps that you'd make for nonviolent resistance to Nazism were not taken, certainly not by governments. So I think before we compare, you know, Gandhi's methods against Hitler, we need to stop and say, let's start at the beginning and put the same amount of money and effort into a nonviolent struggle that's put into a military struggle. Well, it's never been done. We don't know what would have happened. So if you look at Sharpe's dynamics of nonviolent action, which is a set of features of nonviolent campaigns, One of the ones that I've studied in the greatest depth is called political jujitsu. And that's when there's a violent attack on peaceful protesters, which then backfires against the attackers. And that only works because people are outraged by the injustice of violence against nonviolent protesters. And so it's got a moral dimension, whether Sharpe talks about it or not, it's definitely a moral dimension, which is helping to make nonviolence more effective. I'd say the spread of ideas about nonviolence is probably the most promising thing that I've seen in my lifetime. And so what's happening is, before, this was very much a sort of fringe approach. It was seen as utopian, only works in certain contexts, and not relevant for, you know, big time political interactions, you know. And yet now we've got people who are training across the world in the methods of nonviolent action, in the principles, learning fundamental ideas, learning from each other, learning from previous campaigns. And you've got academics who are then providing evidence as well. And of course, the most famous one is Erica Chenoweth and Maria Stefan, who showed that nonviolent campaigns against repressive regimes are more likely to succeed than armed campaigns. So you've got a change both in the research evidence and a change in the way the ideas are being spread. There's still no government that is saying, oh, we're going to change to nonviolence, or we're going to put lots and lots of money into this. No, they're not. But at the grassroots level, it's an enormous change that we're seeing, and the regimes are reacting to it. They're becoming more sophisticated. So there's a constant interplay, you know, between the, you might say, the two sides, the citizen side and the repressive government side. And so it goes on. The way I think of it is that no individual can make, you know, even Gandhi couldn't make, you know, change the entire world. So if you're sitting there thinking, oh, I can't change the world, therefore it's not worth trying, it's the wrong, that's not the way to think of it. The way to think of it is there's a whole network, you might say an ecology of people doing things. You've got people, some people in the highest echelons of government and corporations who are sympathetic to change. And you've got people who are working with those who are most disadvantaged and others who are just trying to survive. And so you say, we're all in this together, and you do your bit where you are, trusting that other people are doing their bit where they are. And that's all that any of us can do. We can't, you know, single-handedly change the way the world's going to go just as well, because otherwise might be a way that we didn't like if someone else did it.